story now, thank you. So he's carrying the cross through from Tirana through to Duras and down to Florence. It was about, I suppose we did a week, but we stayed at this church and this little girl, I think she was about 13, she came. And she prophesied. She said, one of you is going to get shot. It's a great prophecy, isn't it? One of you is going to get shot, and it's the one with a blue t-shirt on. And the only bloke who got a blue t-shirt was Paul.
His lady found a bullet.
This is great, honestly. I'm so pleased. You know, sometimes I mess up church services because I say, just let's forget the preacher for a second, just hug each other or something. I'll pray for each other. I'm not going to do it now. But you know, I sat next to Billy yesterday and Trish, wherever she got there, and I just love. And when you wrote, we're beautiful. What happened, guys, at a certain point at the end, we start singing the old time choruses that I remember in the 80s, you know. And just a simple chorus, and the spirit fell, didn't it? And we're just singing in the spirit, just beautiful, just like now, just like that. And Jesus wants us to be a rugby scrum. He wants to hear our voices or our croaks or whatever. And he wants to share his glory with us. Let me read a little bit out of the Bible. Here we go. I love the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's been speaking all the way through this service. One day, this is a bit of Exodus chapter 33. One day Moses said to the Lord, "You've been telling me to take these people up to the promised land, but you haven't told me whom you will send with me." This is the loneliness that we often feel when God speaks to us. "You have told me, I know you by my name, and you look favourably on, and I look favourably on you. If it is true that you look favourably on me, let me know your ways so I may understand you more fully and continue to enjoy your faith." It's great. Remember that song, "Just a Closer Walk with Thee"? "Just a Closer Walk with Thee." That's my prayer as I'm getting old. I just want to know Jesus. You know, this is Moses saying, "I want to know you more fully and continue to enjoy your favour. And remember, this nation is your very own people." That's us guys now. The Lord replied, "I will personally go with you, Moses, and I will give you rest. Everything will be fine for you." The reassuring nature of God here. The name of the Holy Spirit is the encourager, the one that reassures us, okay? Then Moses said, "If you don't personally go with us, don't make us leave this place. How will anybody know that you look favourably on me and on your people if you don't go with us? For your presence among us sets your people and me apart from all other people on the earth." And you feel a sort of sense of the presence of glory of God even as I read this passage. The Lord replied to Moses, "I will indeed do what you have asked. For I look favourably on you." Moses loved God. Yeah. "And I know you by name." Isn't that great, Moses? This is great. Moses responded then, "Show me your glorious presence." Isn't that an incredible statement out of the Bible? "Then show me your glorious presence." And the Lord replied, "I will make all my goodness pass before you, and I will call out my name, Yahweh, before you. For I will show mercy to anyone I choose, and I will show compassion to anyone I choose. But you may not look directly at my face, for no one may see me and live." Lord continued, "Look, stand near me on this rock, and as my glorious presence passes by, I will hide you in the crevice of the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I'll remove my hand and let you see me from behind, for my face will not be seen." You know, we just sang just now, didn't we, about the glimpse, just a glimpse of the glory. I'm just going to read another bit. This is 2 Chronicles 7. Solomon finished his prayer. As he finished his prayer, fire flashed down from heaven and burned up the burnt offerings and sacrifices. And the glorious presence of the Lord filled the temple. The priests could not enter the temple of the Lord because the glorious presence of the Lord filled it. All the people of Israel saw the fire coming down, the glorious presence of the Lord filling the temple. They fell face down on the ground and worshipped and praised the Lord, saying, He is good. His faithful love endures forever. This is such powerful stuff. You know, I looked across, when I was preparing, I looked across the page from what I've just read, when the presence of God filled the temple, and it's a fantastic verse. I'll throw it in for good measure because it's what God's calling us today as his people here, his people in Great Britain, in Europe, in Russia, in China, in India, and South America, North America, and all over the world. He's saying that if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and restore their land. You know, the words that have been chosen out of these worship songs today, and I've listened to the prayers of you. And as you've been praying, you've kind of been saying all the words that the Lord has been speaking to me about. One last reading out of Hebrews, and then I'm going to preach. You know this passage, it's Hebrews 11, it's powerful, verse 33. By faith these people overthrow kingdoms, ruled with justice and received what God had promised them. They shut the mouths of lions, quenched the flames of fire, and escaped death by the edge of the sword. Their weakness was turned to strength. They became strong in battle and put whole armies to flight. Women received their loved ones back again. Powerful stuff. But others were tortured, refusing to turn from God in order to be set free. Place for hope in a better life after the resurrection. Some were jeered at, and then their backs were cut open with whips. Others were chained in prison. Some died by stoning. Some were sawed in half, and others were killed by the sword. Some went about wearing skins of sheep and goats, destitute and oppressed and mistreated. They were too good for this world. Wandering over deserts and mountains, hiding in caves and holes in the ground. All these people earned a good reputation because of their faith. Father, you've spoken to us already as we gather together. Yeah, there's been common themes coming through the worship. Lord, as I preach now, Lord, I pray to forget the things you don't want me to say and to remember the things you've put into my head to sort of share for the glory of God, Lord. We pray for the glory of God. Don't leave us, Lord. Keep speaking, Lord, as we just share thoughts, share inspiration, share joy, share fire. May your presence continue with us, Lord God. And Lord God, we are your people. You know that, Lord. You know our hearts. Our hearts are right before you. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
I had the joy of being there, sitting in a Baptist church. I love all the churches. Everybody's got a different aspect of God's power. I'm in this Baptist church, and the guy from the front, he says, he writes on his blackboard, on his whiteboard, and the phrase he put on his whiteboard was, "What is the glory of God? What is glory?" So people start giving answers, you know. I'm thinking, my gut reaction, as soon as he said, "What is glory?" I'm thinking, well, and I didn't actually say it, but this is what I think glory. Glory is what I call the wow factor. The wow factor. And as I start praying, it's great when you start preparing to preach, because you start with a blank sheet and then God starts adding bits to the pot, if you like. I read my UCB readings. You know these readings you get every day? UCB readings, you see. And I'm just preparing this thing. I get more excited about this thing. Wow, this word, wow. And I read about this guy. I don't know who he is. He's somebody famous, called Thomas Carlyle. I don't know if you know who he is anyway. And he says this. So I'm reading it. Worship is transcendent wonder. I don't know what transcendent means, but I'm sure it's a good Worship is transcendent wonder. Wonder for which there is no limit or measure. That is worship. Now, I have had too many, God spoiled me. I've had so many experiences in my life where I have had the only thing that I have honestly been able to say is, wow. The age of 25, skinny as a rake, long hair. I went to Yosemite National Park. There was a girl that kind of, I think, I don't know if she was had designs on me, but anyway, she invited me to record this. She invited me to California, see? And there's me from Banbury in Oxfordshire, don't know nothing about California. I think the Evangelical Free Church, they had like a youth week in Yosemite National Park. Now, if you want to go to heaven, I went to heaven that week. It's the happiest week of my life. I'm stuck in this beautiful scenery, and it's like, you know, it's forestry, it's mountains, it's lakes. It's just like if I died and woken up, I would have thought I've got to heaven. And there's me up there. And in the morning, I went, got up really early in the morning, as soon as it was dawn, and I climbed all the little mountains that were around, everybody else was asleep, and I'm on my own, and there was like a and I'm thinking, oh, there's rattlesnakes here. I'm a bit scared. And one rattlesnakes, it was hummingbirds. You get the gist of, and then I went swimming in the lake, and it was warm, you know, and it was just like a cowboy film. Everything was beautiful, you know, and at the night time, it was so warm, we're in our sleeping bags, and then we thought, let's just sleep outside. So we're all there in a line, all of us just lying there. And you know, the only word I could think of saying in English language, I'm just going, wow. Wow, this is myriads of stars, and it's absolutely, you know. Sometimes surfers say, you know, when they're out back, they're not Christians, but they say, I feel something when I'm out back waiting for the wave. And it's something I can't put my hand to. And it's the glory of God. Transcendent wonder. Psalms says, I wrote it out because I didn't want to say it wrong. The heavens proclaim the glory of God. The sky displays his craftsmanship, you know. And I experienced that at the age of 25. And I never really, now I see so much that I just want to have wow glasses on. You know, where you just see the glory of God everywhere. And as I'm getting older, I'm just feeling, wow, this is great to be alive. There's rhododendrons and azaleas and there's bluebells. And there's, you know, I saw a parrot recently. I was in Australia, I saw a parrot. Have you seen a parrot? It's got mauves and greens and incredible colours, yellow, you know, talk about yellow shoes, you know, this is the wonder of God, this is the creation of God. As we get older, we want to wear these wow glasses to see it. I remember being in Scotland once when I was with my dad. He's gone to heaven now, and what a lovely dad he was. You would have loved him, absolutely adored him. Kind of Irish type of guy, you know. And we were only silly billies in October in or somewhere like that, and only silly billies on the campsite, you know, pouring rain, a real typical Scotland sort of experience in Glencoe. And we decided we were going to climb this mountain called Bidium Nambian, and we'd start off, right, silly billies climbing this mountain in the rain, or don't know what we're doing it, and off we go slogging up this mountain, and then we just get to the pyramid at the top. And as I started going up the last 100 metres, probably, 100 yards, just the top, as I start going, just up this last little bit, the light starts to shine. Clouds just, and suddenly, as I get to the summit, I'm looking at a whole carpet of brilliant, shining white clouds. And then, oh no, we're Scotland. It felt like I was standing at the top of Scotland. Got these little peaks. Almost like you could have a guy with bagpipes, you know. Could have a Billy Old with his bagpipes at the top, you know. You could, all right, Billy, you know, and sort of shouting to each other. And I stood there and I said, come on, Dad, I'm in heaven here. And poor old Dad smoked up. He was older and he's like, oh, wow. Then we had to go back down into the rain again, but my eyes have seen the glory of the Lord, you know. Mm-hmm. You can kind of cope with the rain when you had these little incidents in your life. Yes. Praise God. Amen. You know, I was in a party once. I don't go to many parties, but I was in this posh party. There's this posh lady, she got like Rolex watch. Do you know how much Rolex watch just cost? I mean, you're talking about, you could buy a car for a Rolex, you know. You're talking about, and she's got a car outside, £100,000, one of these growling machines, you know, just, oh. And she's talking all about the growling thing she's got outside and a watch and everything like that. And I'm just sort of, she's asking me about what I do, and I say, well, I walk around the world with three bits of wood on my shoulder. And start talking about what I'm doing and people I meet and stuff like that, and just, you know, really, God's been amazing because I've kind of done it on a shoestring, really. God's done it. And I'm just chatting away about my life, and, you know, she suddenly says, hey, let's say, Lindsay, you're awfully rich. And I said, well, no, not really. It's not, you know, it's been pretty, you know, not a lot of money. But, you know, God's been good. No. She says, you are rich. And I suddenly got it. And I said, yeah, I'm rich. And I felt like a sort of American black guy. I'm rich, man. I'm stinking rich. You know what I mean? It's just like, God has done this in my life and I've got so much the glory of God, where God has shown himself. I was in Australia a few weeks ago and I'm snorkeling, you know, and I'm seeing angelfish next to me. You know, amazing oranges and silver and all sorts of stuff going on and the kelp and everything. Felt like I was Jacques Cousteau, you know. I come out, I thought, I've seen something I've never seen before. Just then there was like a Second World War air raid show, siren. I'm going, what's that say? Oh, that's just a shark alert. I was thinking, if I'd met a shark, my prayer life would have improved greatly. But you know, this is the glory of God, and what I want to do, and I'm waiting your whistle to just keep putting on those wow glasses as you walk down everywhere. But you know, one of the things I found the Lord's been teaching me is you see the glory of God, not just in the beauty in creation. I've seen the glory of God in people.
Amen.
Yeah? And sometimes I see a good-looking guy, and I think, God, Pierce Brosnan or whatever, I think, I wish I was like him. No hope for me, but, you know, I go into the hairdresser and say, can you make me look like Pierce Brosnan? But women's magazines, you know, they've got loads of beautiful women in them. And, you know, it's because a woman wants, I want to look beautiful. You know, we are actually designed, God designed us to be beautiful, to carry the glory of God. It's in the Bible. God has decided to share his glory with us, but we've got to have the eyes to see it. So every time I see somebody beautiful, I say, oh, praise God, praise God, praise God. You know, when I was young, very young, I'd be in a Baptist church in Banbury and we'd have the white lady would come. Now, it wasn't a black church. It was a very white church, but I used to call her the white lady, and she'd come to the front every few years on a thing called furlough. I didn't know what furlough meant, but she'd come back from Nigeria and she would stand at the front, all dressed in white, and she just tells stories of what God was doing in Nigeria. And her face would absolutely radiate. Iridescent skin. And as a little boy, I used to love the white lady, Sister Hazel Knowles. And my eyes as a little boy took a glimpse, like we sang just now, of the glory of God, of the Lord shining from this lady, on this lady. In this lady, Moses' face shone. He had to put a veil on it because he'd been in the glory of God, and that can still be true today. Spend time with Jesus And you start smelling like Jesus. People see the glory of God. I was in a prayer meeting recently, and there's a man of God that I know. And I'm praying this prayer meeting. It's all right. It's a bit heavy, you know. And I'm sorry. I'm really, because I've got ants in my pants, I'm not very good in prayer meetings. Unless it's alive, I find I'm really heavy guy. And I'm struggling a bit in this prayer meeting. And suddenly I feel this kind of presence of the Lord next to me. And I'm thinking, whoa, when I start praying with far more power, the presence of Jesus. And I looked to my side, and as my pastor's walked in, he carries the glory of God, he carries the Spirit of God. You spend time with Jesus. Walk out of that perfume shop, get a smell of perfume. What a lesson, isn't it? Worshipping Jesus. You worship Jesus, and worship emanates from your sweat, if you like. Walter Mullis, my boys' brigade officer, similar guy, Sean, still alive. The other day I was in New Quay, and every day I work in a different town in Cornwall. I take the cross, bolt it together, and start walking around the town. And on Fridays I'm in New Quay, and this woman was trying to park a car in the church car park. And she was making a mess of it, you know. I thought, oh, flipping, she's going to bend her car. So I'm doing the little bit of airport duty, you know, that bit. She gets out the car, I don't know, never seen her before, she gets out the car. And I said, you know Jesus, don't you? And she says, oh, how do you know that? No, of course, that was church car park, so it's a bit of a joke. But it wasn't that. Her face shone, she was like a nun. Her face shone with Jesus. Turns out she's just joined the church, she's the worship leader. And her face radiates with Jesus. Sometimes I meet people. You can pick me up afterwards. I know what I mean by this. Sometimes I meet people who are not Christians, and I used to have this problem. I think, I meet this person, he's not a Christian, but he seems to be really loving, and he seems to be so kind, and he's got a great personality. And sometimes I'm on the street and I see these people, and I say, man, you're a good egg, you are. You've got a good heart. And they always kind of look away. I said, well, I try my hardest, try my hardest. I said, no, there's something beautiful in you, you know. And I thought, is my theology wrong? No, it ain't wrong. Right. Human beings are made in the image of God. Mm-hmm. Of course, it's a fallen image, but they are made in the image of God. Mm-hmm. So my life has been transformed by wearing the glasses that see the glory of God on people who are not yet born again. Wow, it's set me free. I was telling Paul last night, I was in Glastonbury Rock Festival, and came across at Glastonbury, used to wander around, they used to call me the Crossman for some reason. thousands of kids, you know, off their heads. First time I did it, they're off their heads, they're smoking stuff and snorting stuff and drinking stuff and doing anything. And they're like, what? It's to kind of walking around depraved humanity, you know? And I'm full of the Pharisee spirit. It exists in British charismatic Christianity. Mm-hmm. Still exists. Yeah. Exists in my heart that day. And I'm thinking, man, what a bunch of wasters. I'm sorry, but that's what I thought. These guys are off their heads. They're just lying next to the fire. They're just kind of, what a mess. And I'm full of this sort of Pharisee spirit. And then I meet this clown. He's a clown, funny, you know, like clowns, like funny nose and all that stuff. And he's beaming with joy, and he sees the cross, and says, oh, praise the Lord, he says, mate. I said, hello, mate, where are you from? I'm from Newquay. I said, I'm from Cornwall as well. What are you doing here? I'm raising money for an orphanage in Romania. I said, oh, that's great, mate, brilliant. Aren't these kids great? That's what he said to me. Aren't these kids great? And I think, yeah, go like that, line out my teeth, obviously. Inside myself, I'm saying, no, they're off their heads, they're, you know. And he said something which transformed my life. It made me turn a corner in my life. I hope it makes turns a corner in your life. He said, I love these kids. He said, I don't know why they love an old kid like me. But they do, but I don't understand it. And I got it in one. I love him because he loves them. Transformed my life. Sometimes on the streets, you know, And sometimes I'm with somebody who's trying to share Jesus, but there's no love.
Mm-hmm.
It's heavy, it's like Jehovah's Witness type stuff. Heavy, 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 heavy. And I don't feel at home because we're supposed to love each other. And I find that love is the bridge to reach into people's hearts. When you love people, the Spirit starts moving because God is love. Oh, Jesus. But you know what I also found in my life? I also find that God can... Sometimes I've met people, I don't want to use that word that describes them, but they're not as beautiful as other people. Put it like that. When I tell the story, you'll understand what I mean. I was in Bangladesh and there were... As soon as you mention the word healing in Bangladesh, you get a long line of people who want to be prayed for because they haven't got the NHS, you know, they haven't got anything. And so suddenly there's this long line of people who want to be prayed for. And it's not like England where you can say a nice long 5-minute prayer and say, by his stripes you're healed, and give a little theological sermon while you're praying for them, like, you know what I mean? You just got to get on with it, you know. And what's wrong with you, mate? A stomach trouble, yeah, right. Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I pray for the stomach. Yeah, because you've got 50 people, right? That's an hour of praying, you just use 1 minute. So Jesus, come against this stomach trouble, in the name of Jesus, come out of this guy. Is that okay? Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. Yeah, the next one, and then it's head trouble. So you pray for the head trouble, headaches. They get a lot of headaches because of the sun and everything. And the next one is back trouble because they do a lot of hard work and they've got back trouble, so you pray for the back trouble. And there you go, headaches and back trouble and head trouble and all that sort of stuff. And then straight in front of me, right in front of me, there's a guy, and I go, oh, like that. It shook me so much, he got half a face. He ain't got the other half.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what happened to him, but he ain't got the other half.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. And our minds aren't used to things that don't quite look like. And I kind of broke down, and I didn't know what to do. I just hugged him. He put his head in my shoulders, and I just hugged him, and just kind of cried, and he kind of cried, and just cried, and just rocked and cried, and it seemed to go on quite long, really. And he eventually pulled away, and he smiled, he says, and I said to my translator, I failed that guy, I don't know, my faith went out the window for healing, for the rest of his faith, I failed him. And he said, no, my friend, he said, you do not fail him. Nobody else would have ever hugged him in his life. You hugged him. The glory of God. He loves the unlovely. I remember looking after little Kitty once. She'd been burnt to fire, and she's just if you were going to make a Hollywood kind of gremlin-y type of person, that's what she looked like. And I used to play fight with her. She was supernaturally strong. I remember, and yeah, I forgot. Didn't take it long before the end of the shift, I'd forgotten. She was beautiful in my eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that the glory of God?
Yeah.
This guy I looked after once. I've got to tell the story because it's beautiful. He didn't have any eyes. I was in care work and did a bank shift and didn't know anything about the guy at all because I'd just been quickly emergency shifts on there. And I'm telling me, just put him to bed. And so I put him into bed. This guy just walks around the house going, like that, with no eyes at all. Absolutely, just skin instead of eyes, and just grunted. And I put him to bed, and I just did what I do, and I used to do with my kids, just ruffled his hair, saying, "Good night, mate. God bless." As I said that, the glory of the Lord filled the room. And I just kind of didn't want to stay there in the presence of God. And I had a lesson, a deep lesson, that dear man could not get into God's good books, could not stand before God and say, I've done this, I've done that, I deserve your love. He couldn't just receive love all his life, just cared for by care workers. And yet God loved him. It's powerful. I remember hearing a BBC documentary about Mother Teresa, and she said to the film crew, BBC film crew, she says, "Today, you are going to meet Jesus." And the cynical film crew, they usually are cynical. You know, I've met a few good ones, mind you. Wonderful, cameramen and guys and lovely people. But they, you know, you could see, yeah, okay. So off Therese goes, Mother Therese goes, and I think they actually film her praying over a guy, actually his last breath, and he's holding her hands, laughing, and she cuddles him, you know. And the whole day is filled with her, caring for people with maggots and lying in their own filth and all that sort of stuff, you know. And then at the end of the shift, the end of the walk around Calcutta, she says to the film crew now, "Did you see Jesus?" I don't think they had their wow glasses on. Didn't know what she meant. Jesus said, "Inasmuch as you've done it for the least of these, you've done it unto me." Mm. That is the glory of God. Mm. You're bringing up your kids on your own, it's the glory of God. You're working as an engineer, it's the glory of God. You're a musician, it's the glory of God. You're a writer, you're a thinker, you're whatever you are, there is no profession if it's in line with the will of God, that's outside God's glory. I've got to have glasses to see it. So sometimes I say to people, "You're glorifying God, mate. What's that? Well, you're really helping to put the roads back together again. That's glorifying God. Hey, yeah," I say to scaffolders, "you're glorifying God, mate. It's a great thing to see. If you can see it, you start to love everybody, the person in the petrol station, the woman on the checkout, you know? You're glorifying God, hey? You're God's girl, mate. You're a good checkout lady. Oh, thank you very much." You know what? Every time I say something nice to somebody, surprise, surprise, they seem to melt. You notice that? So what am I saying? There were some great theological guys with brains in their head. And they got together, I don't know how long they took to get to this deliberation, but they were asked in the Anglican Church of Great Britain to say, what was life all about? What was life all about? What does the Anglican Church believe that life is all about? You know, philosophical types of guys and theological types of guys with more brains than me. And after a long time of deliberation, they came out with a statement. It's called the Canterbury Confession. And it's one sentence. It says, "The chief end of man is to glorify God." Most wisdom is simple, but very profound. Where am I going with this? Sometimes in our life, I read in Hebrews about the miracles. And I love the YouTube testimonies of miracles in India and South America and, you know, sometimes England as well. And we've become a kind of like a Christian community that loves miracles. And I had the chance to see a miracle once. You never really know it when you're praying for people because they always say thank you in these different cultures. But on this occasion, I saw the power of God. I saw a guy in a wheelchair and could we pray for him? We started worshipping Jesus. We started worshipping Jesus, singing over him. As we started singing over him, the glory of God came and the whole of his left side started shaking like an electric current was going through his body and he was shaking. I can't even act it because it was supernatural. And then he stood up. And he starts saying, "Hallelujah, hallelujah." And we prayed, kept on praying. Suddenly God gave his voice back. He said, "Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah." And we're all saying, "Hallelujah." And the glory of God was in that in the garden. I saw a miracle. Oh, we love these stories. But what about the person when they're not healed? What about a friend of mine who got a glorious testimony, her face shines. She had like a brain tumour and they managed to do a miraculous miracle and got the brain tumour out. I interviewed her, you know, and it's just a glorious story of the downs and the ups. Very real story. I could give it to anybody else who's going through suffering. And I just found out recently that the cancer's come back. And I I don't know, but God wants to glorify himself, not just in the wonderful times where the power of God is seen, but sometimes in the times when it's the lowest time, yeah. The The lowest time. I remember reading a story about a guy called Larion Popoff back in the 70s. He wrote a book, Torture for His Faith, and in this book he talks about where the prison governor stood him in a room, and he said, "Popoff," and he could feel the gun on the back of his head, "unless you deny Jesus, I am going to shoot you." Popoff started to cry. "Deny Jesus," and he wouldn't do it. "Deny Jesus," he wouldn't do it. So eventually, after several minutes with Popoff crying and saying, "I cannot deny my Jesus," he hears a click. Then he hears a click again. And then it all goes mental. The guy pistol whipped him because the gun had jammed. He falls to the floor. Well, what he can remember hearing as he got dragged into this subterranean prison cell. Totally black, totally cold, totally damp. He's dragged, and the last words he hears, and they're slamming the door behind him, says, "Popoff, we are going to forget you." And that would have echoed if it was a film. "Forget you, forget you, forget you." And he just broke at that point. And I have had times, I think maybe you have, I don't know, when you've broken. When you've run out of faith. When the glory of the Lord is a million miles away. Have you had those times? I have. Fell off a rock face once. Very quickly. You know what happened? I was carabined to a rope. Poof! And the guy says, "I got you. Get back on the rock. Get back on the rock." And sometimes there's points when the glory of God comes at your lowest point where you have not got any more faith. It's the loneliest point in your life, and I have been there. I've had two marriage breakdowns. I know what it's like to be rejected. I know what it's like to be on the rubbish tip. I know what it's like to be crying, weeping with despair. What happened with Popoff was that as he broke, it's a beautiful story really, as he broke, he felt the arms of Jesus. Somebody said, "God lives on Desperation Corner." Glory of God came in the prison cell. And the reason why we know the story was the next day, the prison governor was removed. They did that in those days in Russia. You know, you could be up there, and then they suddenly do a purge, and they put a new guy in charge, and they kind of, he was set free. So I want to encourage you. You know, when you go surfing, I caught my first wave in Australia the other day. I'm not a surfer. My kids are really high quality surfers. And one of the things about, to catch a wave, you've got to keep on duck diving other waves. And I'm sure in your life, you've had many waves that duck dive, got to keep paddling, duck dive another one, just keep paddling. The only thing you can do for the glory of God is just keep paddling. It's very mundane. It's not very glorious. You can't tell a great story about it. You just got to keep going for Jesus. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Anyway, I get out back, and I don't know anything about really what you're supposed to do. So he's there. He says, "Just look over your shoulder, Dad." "Yeah, right." I'm just sitting on the old surfboard. "Just wait for the wave to come." "There's wave coming now. Start paddling. And suddenly, it's not me anymore. The Holy Spirit takes up. No, not the Holy Spirit. It was a big wave. Spirit. It's like the Holy Spirit. I'm up there. I'm going, "Whoa." And you know what? All you do when you're actually surfing, you just hang on for a dear life. You just, whoa. It's not your power at all. That's a message for us as Christians. We try so hard. I'm getting older now, I'm slowing down. I was manic as a Christian. Too many manic Christians. Too many manic Christians where they're trying hard to be God. They're not God, they're just human beings. They're just human. We're all human, we've all got our failings. But the Spirit of God is what we're praying to. The Spirit of God sometimes comes in power. And I want to just share just a few stories before I finish because it's about the glory of God. Yeah. I want to say that every act of love is the glory of God. That's doesn't matter what it is. If it's loving, if it's kind, if it's beautiful, that's God. But sometimes there are times when you just experience the power of God. And I don't know anything else that's better. A few months ago, I was outside Truro College. On Tuesday, I was just outside Truro College. And all the kids come out, 17-year-olds, don't know the first thing about God. They try to avoid me, some of them, you know, some of them, like, they tease and sneer and do all sorts of stuff. My job's to love them, to try and talk to them about Jesus. I'm there outside the bus stop, and Jacob comes out. Now, Jacob, you'd love Jacob. What a good-looking young black guy. His dad's a pastor. He's got all the little dready things. He's a rap, kind of rap singer type of guy. Mr. Cool. I wish I looked like him. He's a good-looking guy, you know. And I said, Jacob, how you doing, mate? He loves Jesus. Only young guy, 17. I said, and a few months ago, I said, come on, Jacob, let's have a prayer. Before we started praying, a student came up and said, excuse me, can you pray for us? Would you guys pray for us? Because I've got a lot of bad stuff going down in my life, and just wondered if God could help me. And I let dear Jacob do all the talking and do all the praying. And it was fantastic. Jacob got blessed. So anyway, last week, I think it was, Jacob's there. Ah, Jacob, remember last time? I went, sure, another prayer like I did last time. And I pray with him. Suddenly the glory of God descends. Suddenly, like, this guy comes over as soon as we finish praying, saying, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but somebody gave me a Bible in the street a few months ago, and I started reading that. I'm just wondering, I want to know how you can become, I don't know how to put this, how do you actually become, so I finished the sentence off, how do you become a Christian? He said, yeah, that's right. I said, Jacob, explain how you become a Christian. It was like a repeat performance. You could sense that God did it. You pray 1 minute, suddenly God's doing these things. Suddenly it's God at work. And the guy all but gave his heart to Jesus. I know he's going to become a Christian, that kid. And one of the things I found is sometimes you get the two kingdoms side by side. You get the kingdom of darkness and the kingdom of light side by side, and you can see the black and white work of the devil and the work of God. And I was in Newquay last Friday, and I'm there with the cross, and I'm having silly conversations. Come out with me in Wareham, you'll hear lots of silly conversations, like Jesus never had a wheel on his cross, apparently. You know, it's too early for Easter, or something like that. All this silly stuff that people say. And I don't really, I don't want to be on the cross, on the streets just to do the silly talk. I had, you know, half an hour of silly talk, and I prayed with a few people, talked to a few people, but nothing's really happening. And as I get back down to the bottom of the street, there's the bag shop on the right. Now, I've had problems with the bag shop, because the woman in the bag shop, I think, is demonised. Every time I'm near her, she wants to come out and give me trouble. So I'm near the bag shop, forget about the bag lady for a minute, I'm talking to a guy that used to be a Christian, backslidden Christian, and I'm talking to him about Jesus. Coming back to Jesus, and he's like starting to take me seriously, and it's getting deeper and deeper, and suddenly from nowhere the bag shop lady comes out. Flaming banshee. Yeah. She's like, get across out my way of my shop. Her head didn't do 360, but it was like, you know, she's like, this is like, you know. And the guy can't believe it, goes, what? What was that? So suddenly, it's just like, that's kind of spiritual warfare, mate. I said, it's real. You know, what I'm saying is real. Jesus is real. The devil is real. This is real stuff. And just as I said that, because I was backing back a little bit, because the lady's giving me stick, a van just must have clipped the bottom of my wheel. And across suddenly, bang, like that. Oh, you know, like turned into a propeller. It was so like the devil was shaking the cross. It wasn't. I think it was the wheel with the van. But the guy ends up shouting at an expletive. And he said, what's going on? He said. And I said, this is the power of Jesus. This is Jesus at work. He went off. Didn't give his life back to the Lord. I felt 2 inches tall. I felt sort of I'd had dealings with the devil, if you like. I walked around the corner. And I seen a guy. How you doing, mate? He goes. And I said to him, have we talked before? You're a surfer, aren't you? Yeah, man. But have we talked? No. I said, what's your accent? He's, I'm Australian. I said, I just come back from Australia. What are you doing around here? Oh, I'm on a prayer walk. I said, sorry? Did you? I'm on a prayer walk. I said, you're on a prayer walk? He said, yeah, I've got my friends with me. I looked round and there was about 5, 6, 7. Why, wow. Youth of the Mission on a prayer walk. I said, I've just been in, had an encounter, devilish encounter around the corner there. Come on, let's pray. Now, come on, let's pray. Come on, let's pray. It's a little statement you make. God turned up. God turned up. Spirit of God came in power. Presence of Jesus. The light of darkness, but as darkness around the corner, the light of God, side by side. Heavy presence. In fact, so powerful, I couldn't talk. I just, they wanted me to say a prayer. I didn't want to say anything. I'm just standing there with the presence of God. His presence on the street. You cannot orchestrate this stuff. You cannot make this stuff up. You cannot manipulate God. But when God decides to send his glory, it's there. Let's finish with one last story. I was preaching in Green Street Green Baptist Church with John Presley. And I'm in the little prayer room before. I said, Jesus, would you send your spirit? Would you send your glory, Lord? Would you send your spirit? Would you send the wind of your spirit? I'm just praying like this. Anyway, I'm in the service. It was just like it was just today. A wonderful service. Glory of God. It's just great. Loving it. And then I thought somebody's opened a window. And I look around and see if any windows open. No windows open. I think, my hair's just blown. There's a wind blowing. Seriously. Just as I say this, now please, I am not exaggerating, suddenly the heavy presence of Jesus came on me. And John Presley's at the front saying, we welcome Lindsay to come and preach to us. And, you know, we all love Lindsay and send all this lovey-dovey stuff, you know. And I can't get up. The presence of God is on me. I've heard about it from other people. It's not... I couldn't get up. Eventually, just save my embarrassment, maybe I got up and I staggered to the front. And I looked at them. And they looked at me. And I looked at them. And I felt like that guy, John the Baptist, dad, you know, couldn't speak. I couldn't speak. The presence of God was so strong. The glory of the God had descended. You know, that's what I'm looking for. You know, I have to confess, you know. And it's confession. I've tried to steal God's glory in my life. I've loved it when people say, oh, you're a cross man. You know, a bit of glory and be on telly or something like that. Oh, a bit of glory for Lindsay Amen, you know. Whoa. And I'll do a good prayer and people, amen, and they agree with you. You know, you preach well, oh, that's really good. And you take a little bit more glory. But, you know, as I'm getting older, I don't know if I'll ever, this side of heaven, ever get free of this. I don't want glory for myself. I hope this is absolutely sincere, and I hope it is for you. We don't want glory for ourselves. We want the glory of God. That's what you are. That's what you are. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Wow. So sorry it's not been a little Bible study with lots of verses all over the place. But I think the heart of Jesus. It's 20 past, mate. Fun? Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. This week I said to the Lord, Lord, what do you want from me? I thought it through. Some of the answers I could have given in terms of what I might bring to God. What do you want from me, Lord? What do you want from me? And he said these words to me just so deep into my heart. He said this. He said, Paul, what I want from you,
Jesus,
is for you to know that I'm God.
Yeah, he is Lord.
For you to know that I'm God. And it's only as you know that I am God and you worship me and receive everything of the blessings that I want to pour into your life. until you know me as God, you'll never know me. Father, we ask that your holiness would rest upon all of us here in this room. None of us are worthy in and of ourselves.
No, that's true.
None of us are justified by our own good deeds.
Oh, Father.
All have sinned. We have all sinned.
Oh, yes, you
and fallen short of the glory.
Oh,
but we know you loved us so much that you sent Jesus to make it.
Oh God.
Why? All that was wrong. Why? And Lord, it isn't so that we could line up in perfect lines and say, oh, look how good we are.
God, yes, right.
It isn't so that we could work hard and try and prove to the world that you are God.
Yeah, yeah.
Jesus. So that we might know you.
Jesus.
For who you are.
Jesus, Jesus.
And I pray that each one would know
you
for who you are. And that where we have got our misconceptions and inappropriate thoughts about you.
Oh God, forgive us.
Forgive us, Lord.
Yeah, forgive us, Lord.
We don't want to think like wrong.
Father.
About you anymore.
Amen.
We want to think why.
Amen. Jesus.
We want to know you as God.
Your presence, Lord Jesus.
And we know that it's your holiness that draws us into the reality of knowing that you're God. And so we welcome you here.
Yeah, we do.
Right now, Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Remove all of our encumbrances.
Amen, Lord God.
All of our fears, all of our insecurities,
Amen.
All of our sufferings, all of our pain,
God,
all of our hardships, all of our hurts, all of our disappointments, all of our frustrations, all of our anger,
yes, Lord,
all of the inappropriate.
You.
Remove all these things from
Jesus,
us, Father,
Jesus,
and bring to
Jesus,
us the revelation Jesus. Of knowing
Father, it's you. It's all about you.
That you are God.
Amen. It's all about you.
And bless Lindsay, Lord, as he drives back to Cornwall tonight, today.
Yeah.
Spirit be upon him.
Please protect
him. Thank you for keeping him like his two-cylinder man, making him like an eight-cylinder vehicle. Lord, that you've empowered him. He's given the best he can.
Thank you, Jesus.
With his asthma that's plagued him all through his life.
Yeah.
But he just keeps on pumping out the stuff. And Lord, just I pray for Catherine, his wife, and
thank you for
his family, that they would be blessed, his children's children would be blessed, that they would all come to know you and love you. I pray that for all of us, that we would all have the blessing of knowing our children love you and know you like we want them to know you and love you.
Yes, Jesus.
We pray for our community and we pray for our country, we pray for our world, that you would pour out your Spirit in these days upon the lands of the earth. Bring revelation to the hearts of those most confused.
Precious God, we love you.
Come, Spirit of God.
We love you, Jesus.
Pray for the power of your presence.
Your Spirit.
That we might say,
Amen.
I know you.
Thank you.
Bless God.
Father.
Amen.
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 Amen. Well, you've got 5 minutes to get to the lunch. And bless you, everyone. Thank you for being here today with us, sharing in this wonderful opportunity. And there's coffee and tea for those who are not going to rush off to get the lunch. And be blessed. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.